This is a WMUR Commitment 2020 special in partnership with the New Hampshire Institute of Politics. Conversation with the candidate. Tonight, Senator Michael Bennet.
Good evening and welcome to our Conversation with the Candidate series. I'm Adam Sexton and our guest this evening is Colorado Senator Michael Bennet. Tonight we'll be getting to know the senator and where he stands on key issues. At the start of our show, I'll be asking the candidate some questions, and then after a break, we'll have our studio audience ask their questions in a town hall format. But before we begin with that, let's take a quick look at the candidate's biography.
Michael Bennet was born in New Delhi, India in 1964, where his father was working for the U.S. State Department. His family eventually settled in the Washington, D.C. area before Bennet went to Wesleyan University to get his bachelor's degree, then to Yale for his law degree, where he was also editor-in-chief of the Yale Law Journal. Bennet was counsel to the U.S. Deputy Attorney General, special assistant to the U.S. Attorney in Connecticut, then managing director of the Anschutz Investment Company, where he helped to restructure corporate debt. He served as chief of staff to then Denver Mayor John Hickenlooper, who is also currently running for president as a Democrat. Bennet was superintendent of the Denver Public Schools before being appointed in 2009 to fill a vacancy in the U.S. Senate when Ken Salazar resigned. He was elected to the U.S. Senate in 2010 and re-elected in 2016. Bennet is a member of the Senate Committees on Intelligence, Finance, and Agriculture, Nutrition, and Forestry. He is married, has three daughters, and lives in Denver.
Senator Bennet, thank you for joining us on Conversation with the Candidate.
It's nice to see you.
We appreciate
your
time.
I don't know what else there is to say. You guys
well, as long as we got everything right there, we're in good shape.
That was perfect.
First, we want to check in on your health. You had surgery for prostate cancer recently. We know you have a clean bill of health now, but what are some of the takeaways from dealing with cancer?
The primary takeaway is everybody watching this show should go get screened if they have a prostate, and if they don't, go get screened for something else, because I would have never known that I had it. I had no symptoms. And that, I'd say two other things. One, it made me think a lot about what it would be like to get such a diagnosis and not have insurance. It cost $93,000 to have this operation, but my family only had to pay $1,800. Or if you were somebody who just never heard that you had cancer because you didn't have a primary care physician, this is the only country in the industrialized world where there are millions and millions of people that are faced with that because we've got the screwed up healthcare system that we have.
We're glad you're here with us today and back in good health.
It's an amazing thing. 5 weeks ago, I was on an operating table, and 3 weeks ago, I announced that I was running, and I've just been putting one foot in the front of the other ever since.
And this is a question we're asking of a lot of Democrats. This is an epic field of nearly two dozen candidates now. What made you decide that you were the one who could win and be the president of the United
States? Well, in the end, what made me want to run was that I feel like America's really at a breaking point. And I reached my own breaking point during the last government shutdown, that foolish, self-inflicted 35 days where, in the end, the president capitulated anyway, a complete waste of time for the American people. And before I was in this job, I was the superintendent of the Denver Public Schools, where I know there are kids in our school districts all over the country that are counting on us to solve problems before they have to address them themselves. And just like when I left business to go work in the schools, I decided the way I could make the biggest contribution to my country now is by running. And I'm glad that I'm doing it. I'm glad cancer didn't stop me.
Of course, President Trump is the incumbent. What's your strategy for dealing with him if you're the nominee?
I think that we should not make him into this huge figure. You know, he, as somebody said today or yesterday, he consumes that kind of energy and it just makes him bigger and stronger and seemingly more powerful. I think the guy's a really weak president. I think he's been weak on foreign affairs. I think he's been weak on domestic affairs. I think it is critical for whoever runs against him to be somebody who can talk to the middle of the country. I mean, the middle geographically, where Democrats lost and we shouldn't have lost. And I think it's critical that it be somebody who can take him on the truth, because he just tells lie after lie after lie after lie. And at a certain point, you know, people have kind of accepted that as a normal part of politics. I reject that. You know, I think that just like kids in school need to be able to distinguish between edited content, the kind of content you do, and someone shooting their mouth off on the internet, we need to be able to do the same thing with our president and in politics generally, or again, we're going to let down the next generation.
There have been few, if any, television ads in this cycle, but some of them have already been targeting you based on votes on judicial nominees. Do you feel like you owe an explanation to progressives for voting for some Trump judicial nominees?
I'm glad to give you an explanation right now. I think I owe an explanation to everybody about everything that I do. I take very seriously my responsibility to advise and consent in the Senate, and still, knowing that, I have voted for five times fewer Trump nominees than President Obama voted for George Bush nominees. I have opposed two-thirds of the nominees on which we've taken an actual vote, and it's disgraceful that they're on the court. A lot of those people are people that are have strong ideologies, they're very right-wing. A lot of them don't have the experience or the judicial temperament that's needed. But where I see somebody who does have the judicial temperament that is required, where I think they will have an open mind, I will vote for them, even if Donald Trump is putting them on the court. Donald Trump doesn't own our courts.
A lot of candidates in this race on the Democratic side support Medicare for all, debt-free college, some even talking about reparations for slavery. Do you worry that your party is moving too far to the left?
Well, I worry that we're putting ourselves in a position where we can be disqualified by President Trump. I mean, if President Trump, if you hear him say the Democrats are socialists, he's trying to disqualify us. If you hear him say Democrats are for open borders, he's trying to disqualify us. If you hear him say Democrats hate Israel or are anti-Semitic, he's trying to disqualify us. So I think that we should understand that's what he's trying to do and make sure we don't make it easier for him than it otherwise would be. But we're also going to have the opportunity in this campaign to have a big competition of ideas, to figure out what the National Democratic Party wants to stand for and the agenda we want to make sure we can not just beat Donald Trump, which is critical, but govern the country again on the back end of this. I've been in the Senate for 10 years now. It seems like 100 years, but I've been there for 10 years and I've gotten a bunch of things done, but I also know why things don't get done. And even before Trump showed up, President Trump showed up, we were not governing. And it was broken down. And now we have to figure out a way to resurrect it if I'm not going to be part of the first generation that leaves less opportunity, not more, to the people that are coming after us.
Is there one particular idea or policy or leadership trait that you would want voters to associate with Senator Michael Bennet?
Yeah, that I tell the truth, no matter how inconvenient it might be.
Simple as that. All right, Senator Bennet, these were the easy questions.
Thank
the
you.
Tough questions await from our New Hampshire voters.
I'm
coming up after the break, we'll bring in our studio audience into the conversation. Stay with us.